Hi, I'm Tayla, and welcome to everyone online and here. There we go. So I, in the program, wrote a little bio about myself, and I thought I would kind of sum it up with some pictures to just give you guys more of an idea of who I am, which I'm sure you all know pretty well. So, who am I? I am a list lover. I'm a wannabe breakdancer, as I'm sure you all know. I'm a movie fanatic. I'm a baby goat admirer. I'm a theater dropout. Yes, I was Rizzo. I'm a jingle jangle footwearer. I'm an LGBTQIA plus supporter. I'm a funny face maker. I'm an ex-dreadlocker, I'm a tattoo enthusiast, I'm a glitter nut, I'm a dance floor devotee, I'm a loyal friend, and most of all, I'm graciously grateful for this life that I've been blessed with. So I decided to share my own personal journey with you guys today, just from being in a place of complete darkness, then into a place of light and clarity. So I'm not telling you this to stroke my own ego or just talk about myself, but rather to share and inform you about my discovery of transformation back to a better self. And that's who I am today. So I was always quite outgoing and quite quirky, as I'm sure you all know. Acting was my passion in high school. I always felt very at home and very safe when I portrayed the characters on stage. I was very confident, had a very wacky sense of humor, and I wasn't the typical academic stereotype. I was just kind of much your average girl. I absolutely loved people, and I loved life, except for narcissistic ex-boyfriends and Cape Town drivers. So, as you know, this is me today, which I'm sure you all know very well. However, in 2019, this girl was hiding. So, going into a very dark depression was something that I'd never imagined myself being in, but it happened. I went from being a Golden Key member and a Dean's Merit List recipient to failing my entire second semester in second year and leading down a very dark path. This is what I had turned into. So, what triggered this very nasty depression was a very nasty breakup, leaving a very toxic relationship, and having to deal with the unformidable death of my friend Yui Nene. Loving people and socializing was always something I loved to do. However, at this point, I did not leave my bedroom. I slept in my bedroom, I ate in my bedroom, I worked in my bedroom, I spent every minute in my bedroom. And I just had panic attacks, I had hives all over my body, off the charts anxiety, shaking uncontrollably, which eventually led me to such a hopeless state that I tried taking my own life. And to really just relieve the pain and anguish that I was feeling. And I mention this brief description of these symptoms just to show you a contrasting effect of who I was and who I am today. So, I could not pinpoint this pain for a very long time. I had no idea why it was coming up, and I had no idea what I was feeling. And after moments of clarity and moments of reflection, and also having to deal with the pain that most South African women dealt with in October 2019, I came to a place of clarity, realizing why I was feeling this way. When I was just 10 years old, I had a near rape incident happen to me. And I had kept this bottled up inside for 9 years, and I had not told anyone. I had only come out to my parents in 2019 about what had happened after already having the triggering effect of PTSD. I kept it bottled up for so long, and once I told my parents, I did feel that this massive weight was lifted off my shoulders, but I'd really lost the true essence of who Tayla was, and I had absolutely no idea how to get her back. And this is what led me into a very dark hole. So I was prescribed antidepressants and anti-anxiety medication from my psychiatrist, but they had absolutely no success whatsoever. So I decided then to fly home back to Joburg to see my mom's physician as a last resort. I got back home, went to the session, and basically after going back and forth with her, she mentioned this incredible new scientific discovery, a ketamine infusion. Like, oh my God, you can imagine, my eyes popped out of my sockets. I was like, what the hell are you going on about? I mean, being coined a party drug, you know, my mom's first reaction was, you know, listen, I know Tayla likes to party, hey, but this is a little bit too extreme for my liking, okay? It's no shame, she actually doesn't speak like that. I just had to throw in some Constantia flavor over there. So my physician then spoke to me and said that there'd been enormous amounts of success of the results of people who are dealing with depression and severe anxiety. So overwhelmed with this bucket load of information, she gave me an enormous amount of research and info to go home and look at before I made this massive decision. So before I get into like the cool, like trippy things that I saw and like what I felt and if I turned into a feral Kayla, I have to give you a nice boring lowdown of what ketamine is and what it does. So good old Google says that ketamine is a medication primarily used for the induction and maintenance of anesthesia. It induces dissociative anesthesia, a trance-like state providing pain relief, sedation, and amnesia. So this is Google's definition, but I'm sure partygoers may have something else to say. So going on from that, so recently it is a drug being used as potent and fast-acting antidepressant, which has been outperforming traditional antidepressants by a considerable margin. So this drug, most is famously known for its dissociation. It produces a feeling of detachment from the self and from the reality. So with antidepressants, they normally take about 6 weeks to 6 months to kick in, but ketamine within the first few infusions, you typically start noticing a difference. And 2 days after my first infusion, I noticed a distinct difference. So what does ketamine do to the brain? Ketamine infusions alter the neurochemistry through the inner neurons. You're not altering it directly by injecting dopamine or serotonin into the system, but you're rather getting the brain to modulate better. So every person will have a different experience whilst under an infusion. They might develop insight or different narratives of what life is or what it could be. And one of the common outcomes, which is really beautiful, is the ability to treat themselves more kindly. And then you begin to see under the infusion how to do that. So some of the conditions that it treats is depression, anxiety, addiction, and PTSD. So recently, in more recent studies, there's also been a way of seeing how ketamine can treat OCD and chronic pain as well. So now, how did ketamine become illegal? So quite an interesting story. So it was actually always legal up until the late 60s. And what had happened was during the Vietnam War, the nurses were administered ketamine to use as an anesthetic for the soldiers who were very badly wounded. And in that time, the soldiers would come and do the ketamine, and they were like, cool, this makes them feel quite good. And then started stealing it from the nurses to inject themselves with and run into battlefield in order to not be able to feel any pain when wounded. So this is why it was illegalized in 1970 by the FDA. So through the breakthrough of ketamine, neuroscientist Rebecca Brachman and her team of science were testing the effects of alternate medications on the brain for treatment-resistant depression. And this is how the breakthrough came. So they originally first started with two mice. So what had happened was, so these drawings are actually taken from Rebecca's experiments. So they are obviously dramatized. And these purple paths over here indicate the foot traffic of the mice. So they had two mice, normal mice, having a jaw, having a lack of time, didn't put them under any stress, they were just normal guys, and put them in a cage and they ran around, did their thing, were just being normal. Then, the next slide, both of these mice they took and they stressed them. So they shook them up, bullied them a little bit, you know, I don't know, clapped the one. And then, so they were really, really stressed, put in a very stressful environment and put back into their cage. And as you can see, the foot traffic is basically nothing. They all hid in their little huts. They probably just came out for a wee and that was about it. So then in the next slide, calypsol, which is a derivative of ketamine, they injected one of the stressed mice with this calypsol. And once they did that, the mice that was under stress with no calypsol still hid in its hut, didn't do anything. And then the mouse with the infusion of calypsol, still under the stressful condition, came out and was running around and doing its thing. So basically, still in its very stressed being, it was just being normal again. So they were so gobsmacked by like this incredible discovery that they actually landed up sending it to 40 labs around the world for the scientists to test and experiment the exact same thing. And every single lab came back with the exact same result. And they were like, oh my God, like this is crazy. So eventually then they were like, cool, we're ready to now test it on humans. So after doing all of this research before my infusion, I was really armed with all the necessary information and the sheer desperation to free myself from the paralyzing black hole, I made my first appointment. So to just explain a little bit about how the infusion works and the setup. So you walk in, there's a very uncomfortable medical bed, and they put a drip inside of you with the ketamine in the bag, and then they hook you up to all these wires just to test your neurological abilities. And then they give you an eye mask. Now this is very important as it doesn't distract you from the external environment. So basically you're allowed, everything then is in your head and in your soul. So nothing is taking you into something that you're distracted from on your overall senses. Then also what's very important is the music. So you put earphones in and you have to choose something really calming, something that you feel is going to be really suitable to the environment and to set your intention for the infusion. So also songs also have vibrations and frequencies, just like humans. We are made up of sounds and frequencies and vibrations. So you're obviously in quite a vulnerable state. So you're not going to go and choose Slipknot, you know, to listen to, but something more calming, I don't know, like a Bob Marley or meditation music. I have quite a light and gentle frequency, so I had to be very careful about what I chose. And then lastly, also time. So the timing is just over an hour that you are in or under the infusion. However, it can feel like completely different times to anyone who does it. So the first two sessions I had felt about 3 to 5 minutes, even though it was under just over an hour. And the last session, I actually felt like I was trapped in there, and I felt like I was in there for 30 years. So how was I feeling before the session? Extremely nervous. I had absolutely no idea what to expect. But so my physician came in, and what she said she would do is she would come in every 10 minutes and hold my arm just to ground me and make sure I was feeling safe. And that really helped, and it made me a little bit more excited. Then during, this picture is a perfect example of how I was feeling. I felt like I had a complete out-of-body experience, complete hallucinations, and very vivid dreams. I also went into REM sleep, which is very important. As your sleep cycle, it stimulates the areas of your brain that are essential in learning and making or retaining memories. Then afterwards, I felt like this, just not as rich. But on a serious note, I did feel like this afterwards. So I felt like I had been hit by a bus. I was like couldn't string a sentence together. My body was limp. I felt very uncomfortable. My vision was skewed. I went to bed for 5 hours, woke up not knowing where I was. So basically I did turn into a feral Kayla. So what did I see during my first session? So something very important that came up were the colors. So the first session I saw purple peacocks. I saw space in a very purple light. And when I was listening to Tash Sultana's Notion soundtrack, the actual sound waves were making these beautiful little roller coasters as which I was sliding down and like going woohoo. And the one point when I was in space, I was actually floating up in space, and every star I would touch would get brighter. And my physician actually came to me afterwards and said when she walked in, I was doing this with my arms, trying to touch these stars. So the role of music and color was very vital, especially the color purple. Then in the second session, a massive thing for me is I saw purple elephants dancing. and I saw monks floating in an orange and yellow space. So I think I'd just gone to Thailand before this, so I probably think it was a connection between a monk monastery and elephants. But after this infusion, funny enough, I actually became repulsed at the fact of eating meat. So I completely stopped eating meat for 2 months afterwards as well. And I carried on wearing the color purple and yellow as well from the colors that I saw. So this is just a little something of, so I went to Thailand after my first infusion and I was so happy to the point that I'd actually dislocated my jaw from doing the worm, knowing me. And I was so happy to the point where I did not even experience the pain, and I was just really happy being in a head brace, pretending to be a Teletubby, the son from Teletubbies. So my third session, it was very scary. I experienced something called an ego death. And so in the session, I'd actually felt like I had died. And it was very, very scary. And basically my body was floating and I could see it, and it was going further, further away. And I felt like no one was coming to wake me up. So an ego death, it's an experience. It can be very terrifying, liberating, exhilarating, and full of absolute awe. Certain substances such as DMT, ayahuasca, peyote, LSD, and ketamine, taken in very different quantities, have a strong reputation of being able to push the mind or soul over the edge, allowing it to seemingly detach from its bodily counterpart. Often hard to put into words, this can create a state that some have called an ego loss, an ego death, or an ego disillusion. So basically, ending off on this third session, I felt like a part of me needed to die. And this was the part of being anxiety. So I have never experienced anxiety since. Completely, I've never experienced depression, anxiety, or PTSD since. And I felt like I was rid of all of these capabilities and anything that hindered me of attaining self-love. So hammering these negative disorders away, I finally have the capability to do it. And I've never experienced anxiety, PTSD, or depression ever again. And I'm very grateful and thankful for this experience, and that I feel like I am the person that I am supposed to be. So I'm very growing more each day just to love myself a little bit more. So this was my experience, an experience that I believe is worth sharing. So if you know of someone who is suffering from these illnesses, please can you pass this information on to them as well. With depression often being so misunderstood and unsuccessfully treated long term, I feel compelled to share my story in hope of helping others. So life is for the living, so let's live it. So through my journey, I made up a little mantra which I say to myself twice a day, every single day. I am happy, I am healthy, and I am living. And to end off, I would like everyone to please say it with me. I am happy, I am healthy, and I am living. Thank you.